Ever wonder why things float in water? Why you can lift more weight underwater than you can on land? And why does ice float? The physics behind why these things happen is both intuitive and complex, and its implications to life on Earth might surprise you. Floating in water is a relaxing sensation that many of us have experienced, but why does it happen? The reason has to do with something called hydrostatic pressure. Our planet, like any massive object in space, exerts a strong force of attraction onto other objects. We call it the gravitational force, and we live with it and are bound by it every day of our lives. The force of gravity between two objects was defined by Sir Isaac Newton's law of universal gravitation in 1687, and it is defined by a gravitational constant g, multiplied by the mass of the two objects divided by their distance apart squared. Because of this, Earth behaves like one big attractor, pulling all matter towards it to form the complex habitat we call home. How the four states of matter, solid, liquid, gas, and plasma, interact with one another in many ways defines what life is like here. Material in the solid state, like rocks at the beach, are characterized by strong intermolecular forces that hold the material tightly together. Solids form the skeleton of our existence, from the bones in our bodies to the trees of the forests and the coral reefs of the ocean. Material in the liquid or gas state is uniquely different. Here, intermolecular forces are not strong enough to keep the material closely packed together, and its shape and volume more easily changes. We call this a fluid. While solids form the structure on which living things are built, it is the fluids that enable energy to flow through them such that life can exist. It's the coexistence of solids, liquids, and gases, all at the same time, all on the same planet, that is thought to be the secret ingredient that led to the formation of living things on Earth. And as if that wasn't cool enough, it also creates some pretty fascinating phenomena, like our ability to float in water. Because fluids like water deform under load, they cannot distribute forces like solids can. So the deeper you are underwater, the more weight you feel crushing you. We call that powerful force hydrostatic pressure, and it's the depth dependence of hydrostatic pressure that's the link to understanding how and why things float. A classic mathematical explanation involves submerging a solid cube. We can calculate the forces it feels on each of its faces as the hydrostatic pressure at that depth multiplied by the surface area of the face. Because of fluidity, hydrostatic pressure acts inward, perpendicular to any submerged object's surface. For a cube, that means we have six faces that experience inward pressure. The side faces are all located at the same depths, so the forces on one side are equal and opposite to the forces on the other. What happens to the top and bottom faces? The bottom face is deeper than the top, which means the hydrostatic pressure experienced there will be a little bit greater. This difference in pressure creates a net upward force on the submerged object. And with a little bit of math, it turns out that force is equal to the volume of the submerged object multiplied by the density of the fluid and the acceleration due to Earth's gravitational force. Doesn't matter if you change the shape to a sphere or a cylinder, any object of any shape, the answer is always the same. This upward force is so important, it has its own name. It's called the buoyancy force, and it was first discovered by a Greek mathematician named Archimedes of Syracuse over 2,200 years ago. The concept itself is named after him. In physics, it's called the Archimedes principle. So now that we understand buoyancy, let's examine why do things float? If we place an object in a fluid on Earth, it will experience two competing forces: gravity, pulling the object downwards, and buoyancy, pushing the object upwards. If the total weight of an object is greater than the buoyancy force it produces when fully submerged, it'll sink. But if not, the object will sink just deep enough until sufficient buoyancy is created, and it'll float. To see this in action at home, let's take a water bottle and fill it with rocks. We'll weigh the bottle, place it in water, and mark its waterline, the depth it sinks to when floating. Now what happens when we add more rocks? The weight increases, and if we put it back in the water, we notice that the waterline shifts to a deeper position. Here, the increased mass of the rocks added forced the container to sink deeper in the water until a sufficient buoyancy force was created to balance the downward force of gravity. If we add too many rocks, the entire container will eventually sink. This is the same concept that naval architects use to determine the carrying capacity of a boat, and why you should never, ever, ever overload a boat with too many people. Other fun examples of buoyancy in action include choosing the right surfboard. High-volume surfboards like SUPs provide enough buoyancy to float your entire body, whereas a shortboard will not. Or if you have a scale at home, you can watch what happens to the weight of an object when you submerge it in water. It goes down. And while the buoyancy force and being able to float in water may not seem all that important, it has some enormous implications. Water itself is extremely unique because of its atomic structure. Because of two hydrogen atoms bonded asymmetrically to oxygen, solid water, or ice, has a greater volume than liquid water, and because of Archimedes' principle, it floats. Early in Earth's history, it's very likely this characteristic of water played a pivotal role in the formation and evolution of living things. As the temperature drops and bodies of water begin to freeze, ice floats to the top, creating a surface layer that insulates the liquid water below. If ice were denser than liquid water, it would sink, and every winter, bodies of water would freeze entirely, making it much more difficult for life to survive. In fact, some scientists hypothesize that intelligent life would not have emerged on Earth without the buoyancy characteristics of ice. So next time you're enjoying a relaxing float, remember Newton, Archimedes, and that incredibly fortunate hydrogen bond in water, because your, my, everybody's existence very well relied on it.